Next topic I would like to discuss is the question of how suitable yoga and Christianity are for the development not only of humans but also for other beings. So let's start with yoga. So if we look at the first forms of yoga, the Bhakti yoga and the Karma yoga, we find that they are very generally applicable. By an animal opening its heart, it can form a connection with a higher being, and that connection can create a very strong bond between it and the higher being. The energy will flow from the higher being to the lower being, and they will be joined in a way like a master and their faithful hound. So, for other spirits and nature spirits, or even animals and plants, they really do have hearts, they do have emotions, and they do form attachments, and they can form attachments with a certain place. Many nature spirits are very attached to where they live or to the animals and plants in their domain. And animals are also naturally can be very fond of their mates, their owners, or the region where they live. And through this love, they become very much one with it and also receive communication and guidance, for instance, from greater nature spirits, which are helping them to survive in those areas. So Bhakti yoga is basically available form of religion for all beings. Karma yoga, in a way, showing a certain type of behavior to guide your own change of form and to move into a different form of incarnation, is also a practice which can be done by animals, because they, more than stones or trees, have the possibility to change their behavior. So even though an animal has very strong instincts, they can try to emulate something else. They do have a personality. An animal can be, you could say, like more naughty, more human-like, more stupid, more aggressive. And ultimately, by having these traits and choosing to develop certain traits and choosing to repress other traits, just like we humans do, also an animal can make choices. And these choices will define their future forms. So an animal can move from one species into another species, and eventually this is also how an animal spirit eventually incarnates into a human form, by, in a way, trying and wanting to be a human, being human-like, and eventually you get a form which suits your habits. This is also why humans, in a way, are very still ruled by their instincts, are still very animalistic, because our spirits spent a lot of time in those different forms. The Jnana yoga is a lot more difficult for many forms of being. So to develop an understanding, we need to have enough of a mental capacity to and ability for abstraction, to really understand not just our experiences but also the relationship between experiences. Like a young child can understand that if she flicks a switch, the light will go on or will go off, but usually an animal doesn't understand why it is light or dark, or has no concept of that it would be possible for it to change light to darkness. So depending on the capacity, you could say, of the brain, Jnana yoga is more or less possible. The physical form is, in a way, by definition, a form which makes Jnana yoga quite difficult, compared to forms in a higher state of consciousness. So Jnana Yoga, you'll find, is practiced a lot on the higher astral, where the spirits have a much clearer awareness, which is not so cluttered by our human illusions, by emotions, by instincts. And there is really a superb understanding of spiritual laws, of the nature of the cosmos, of the why of things, far beyond our human understanding. So Jnana Yoga is difficult for material beings, actually, including us humans, although we humans, for material being, are doing decently well at it. And also for other primitive forms, so in the lower astral it is very hard, but the higher you go, the more practicable it is. So then we come to the more typical form of yoga. As I said, the lower steps are in a way the same as karma yoga, just building good behavior. Then we come to the process of, in a way, opening the energy channels, moving the energy through those channels, and then finally, as in a way our consciousness becomes clearer, using that clearer consciousness in meditation and concentration. And even though, like, apes watch the sunset and cats can stare for hours at a place where they think a mouse is hiding, it is not the same level of meditation as a yogin or a yogini would practice. So I wouldn't say that the whole essence of the Raja Yoga is very applicable to other life forms. I do see that if an animal is in a way doing the postures, like my dog doing the downwards dog, yes, they are stretching their energy channels, it is good for their health. For an animal to use its body, to move its body, to stretch, to change its posture, yes, this is also creating positive health benefits, both in humans as well in animals. And also the energy channels are not that different in other mammals. It becomes quite different if you move to fish or other things. So wouldn't know if they would benefit in the same manner from yoga as mammals do, but mammals definitely have benefit from yoga postures. And even also moving the energies, stimulating the energy bodies, stimulating their development by inciting their passion, their desire, their love, their loyalty, their higher vibrations will also work. So step 3 and 4 of the yoga are also applicable to animals, but I don't think that the other steps are very suitable for them. As to non-embodied beings, if we look at the we could say the sins and the virtues, they exist also on higher levels. It's also on higher levels it is possible to try to change that, to work on that. Postures, of course, is not really